Hello guys, welcome to my channel Connect with Civil. This video deals with the design of plain concrete footing. Suppose we have a situation where the column is relatively lightly loaded and the base area requirement by the footing is relatively low. In such condition, it is very much economical to provide simple concrete block as footing. This type of footing is also known as pedestal footing. Now, let's see how the design of plain concrete footing is done with the help of a sample question. Design of plain concrete footing. Here is a question for you. Design a plain concrete footing for a column 300 mm by 300 mm carrying an axial load of 330 kN. Assume allowable soil bearing pressure of 360 kN per meter square at a depth of 1 meter below ground. Assume M20 concrete and Fe415 steel. Let us analyze the given question. We have to design a plain concrete footing. The dimension of the column which our footing carries is 300 mm by 300 mm. The column carries an axial load of 330 kN. The allowable bearing pressure of the soil where footing has to be laid is 360 kN per meter square at a depth of 1 meter. That means the bottom of our footing should be at a level of 1 meter below the ground. Concrete we have to use is of M20 grade and steel is of Fe415. When we picturize the given data, this is how it looks like. This is the plan details and this is the sectional data. So we have to find the dimensions, that is length L, breadth B and depth D of the footing. Before going to the design, let us understand what a plain concrete footing indicates. It means there is no reinforcement in the footing. Force transfer happens at the column base without the need of any reinforcement at the interface. It is possible when the bearing stress produced by the ultimate load at column base is less than the maximum bearing stress offered by the footing concrete. So while design, we can opt the plain concrete footing when the factored axial load is less than the limiting bearing resistance. Now we have to check the condition mentioned in the previous slide. At the left hand side, we have factored axial load. This can be found by multiplying the given service axial load with the load factor of 1.5. So now we are done with the LHS. On the right hand side, we have the limiting bearing resistance of the concrete. We have a formula to calculate the limiting bearing stress. Here, FCK is 20 Newton per meter square. A1 is the supporting area. Since we are calculating the stress at the column footing interface, the area will be the same as the column area. A2 is the loaded area and in any case it's column area only. That is 300 mm by 300 mm in this case. Now we are with the limiting bearing stress of 9 Newton per mm square. In order to get the limiting bearing resistance, we have to multiply this stress with the supporting area. The maximum bearing resistance 810 kN is greater than the factored axial load of 495 kN. So definitely we can go with the plain concrete footing for this axial load. In order to find the size of the footing, we have to divide the total load with the bearing pressure of the soil. Total load that the footing has to carry will be the sum of the axial load from the column, weight of the footing and weight of the backfill. Since we don't have the dimension of the footing at this stage of design, we can assume the weight of footing and weight of backfill together as 10% of the axial load. So 330 kN plus 10% of 330 gives the total load. Dividing this total load by the given bearing pressure of 360 kN per meter square, we get the footing area required in this condition. Since our column is square in plan, we can adopt a simple square footing. Thus, we have arrived at the planned dimension of the footing as 1 meter by 1 meter. Next step is to find the thickness of the footing. If the footing base comes within the internal pressure dispersion zone, the entire force from the column can be transmitted to the footing base by compression or strut action. We can calculate the depth using this condition. In this figure, the inclined red line indicates the dispersion zone of internal pressure on one side. Alpha is the angle between the dispersion line and the base of the footing. From the figure, we can make out tan alpha is equal to d divided by L minus b by 2, from which we get the expression for depth d. In order to find the value of alpha, code specifies this equation. Here Qmax is 0.36 Newton per mm square, Fck is 20 Newton per mm square, and L is 1000 mm and B is 300 mm. So we are with the value of tan alpha as greater than or equal to 1.506. We get the value of D as greater than or equal to 527 mm. So we can adopt a depth of 530 mm in this condition. We know in plain concrete footing, the force transfer takes place without the need for reinforcement and by strut action. The imaginary stress struts, as shown in the figure in the previous slide, are inclined to the vertical line, and the horizontal component of this causes some tie action. In order to take care of this tie action and to provide adequate resistance against temperature and shrinkage effect, we need to provide a minimum reinforcement. We have a formula to calculate the minimum area of reinforcement, that is 0.12% of BD. So we got 636 mm square area. Now we have to select the diameter of the bar you are going to use and divide this minimum area with the area of one bar to get the number of bars required. Suppose if we are using 12 mm dia bar, the calculation after round off will give you the number of bars as 6. Now you can calculate the actual area of reinforcement with these 6 numbers of 12 mm dia bars. Since our footing dimension is same in both directions, we can provide the same area of reinforcement in other direction also. So as per minimum area requirement, we have to provide 6 numbers of 12 mm dia bars both ways. We are done with our design now. Next thing is to compare the actual base pressure with the soil bearing capacity to assure the safety. Do you remember, while calculating the footing area, we have made some assumptions on weight of footing and backfill. Now, since we have the entire dimensions of our footing with us, we can find out the actual base pressure. Here, we can consider the unit weight of concrete as 24 kN per meter cube and soil as 18 kN per meter cube. Please refer the picture with all the dimensions marked. Axial load 330 kN divided by the footing area 1 meter by 1 meter gives you the pressure due to axial load. If you multiply the unit weight of concrete 24 kN per meter cube with the depth of footing 0.53 meter, you will get the pressure due to weight of the footing. Similarly, if you multiply the unit weight of soil 18 kN per meter cube with the height of backfill 0.47 meter, you will get the pressure due to backfill. Addition of all these three components will give you the total base pressure. Here the base pressure we got is less than the given allowable soil pressure of 360 kN per meter cube. So, our design is safe. Here comes the detailing part. This is the sectional arrangement. The footing dimensions and the distribution of reinforcement along both directions are shown. Similarly, the arrangement is shown in Plan 2. This sample picture shows how the arrangement of reinforcement is done. This is not our footing, this is intended to show only the arrangement of reinforcement. Let me list out the steps once more. First, we have to compare the factored axial load with the limiting bearing resistance to check the adaptability of plain concrete footing. Secondly, find out the base area required by dividing the total load by the given soil bearing pressure. Select suitable plan dimensions according to the calculated area. Next, calculate the depth of footing using the specified formula. Calculate the minimum reinforcement area required to take care of the tie action. Select suitable diameter of the reinforcement and find out the number required. Finally, find out the actual base pressure and compare it with the allowable soil bearing pressure. If the design is safe, proceed with the detailing part. Thank you.